Yes. Hey, everybody. Hey, are you? I'm really glad to see so many. I was wondering if people could find the second floor, but it actually was more than good. Today, I really want to talk to you about Docker best practices and how you're basically, you maybe looked at Docker, tried it, deemed it worthy, deemed it not worthy. And I think we are also kind of getting to this stadium of we have got enough Docker. Docker has been like everywhere, it's been a buzzword, everybody tried it, and now we're saying, okay, what is then, now we have to actually figure out, do we want to use it other than just the hype? And I think I want to talk about like what is good in development, what have I learned, and how the, some of the things that I've applied and figure out during the years I've been using it. And I have been using it since 2004, and there I can say it was shitty, so I'm glad you're here in 2018. It's pretty good. The speed is up there, and we're actually getting to a point where it's like, okay, now it's actually usable and fun to use. So, and I think it really something about like how many people are using Docker right now? Okay, everybody, that's good to see. How many are using in production? Okay, half. That's also, so I have somebody or you to convince, but I think also maybe have some of you to actually convince on how to actually improve some of the security that is kind of what it's talking all about. Like Docker is basically some of the things where you're basically thinking, how can I improve some of the really difficult things to test? So one of the first thing I really want to talk about is the development mode. It's where we spend a lot of our time. And I think like everybody's like having these where they're using Docker Compose. But I think it's also something like where you're saying like, I have this app, I know how to run it without Docker. I have not needed Docker for the many years, and I don't need it now. And I think Docker Compose has been a tool that I've used a lot, but I actually began to use it less and less. Because like when the start was like, I was thinking about, oh, I can run all these containers, I can run them all at the same time, I can run databases left and right, graph databases, MySQL, I can run two of them if I want to. And I'm actually beginning to come to this realization of, okay, it's good that I can run many containers, but I'm not actually working on all of them at the same time, so it's actually not so useful as I thought it was. But I think one of the things with Docker is basically how simple you can get started. And I think even though if you are not using Docker, I would argue that anybody can figure out how to actually put Docker Compose into their repository. Because you're suddenly only needing this amount of lines to have an initial Docker Compose file, and you're basically having something that new developers can come and build on. And the thing here is actually a challenge for everybody. Who here can actually bring up their development environment in one command? So, and this is why I think like this is something really you should consider. You may not using Docker, or you may do, but I think the challenge is actually, and the real thing about Docker is bringing everything up in one command. And bringing it up in one command seems silly, but it's something that if you are trying to onboard new people and you are thinking about how is it that I can make it so it sucks less to develop, or I have to answer fewer questions from my colleagues because they're having questions for the third time about how do you set this up. It's actually a challenge, and it's very difficult to bring everything up in one command, but it's possible to do, and I think this is some of the things that, for me, is still the most impressive thing about Docker. It's something where you're saying, is it working, or is it not? If it's working, you can basically have one command, bring everything up, bring a database up, load the database schemas in, do the migrations, load the initial data in for the application to run. You can even do some of the health checks to see that it's actually running. And this is maybe something where like you're maybe running it on your own computer, but it's also something you can actually run Docker Compose on your continuous integration. And this is something I've done and I continue to do and I will always do, because you're not having any questions about if it's working or not, or you basically have a proof of is it like working or not in when you're using continuous integration. And I think another thing when we begin to go into more of these in-depth, where we can actually configure these small things, is actually the permissions of the user who is running the application. Because I think sometimes it's easy just to run everything as root, and you're probably beginning into this downhill, because once you have gone root, it's really difficult to go back. And this is also some where you're thinking, maybe some of the permissions that I have is not the correct one. I'm actually running the containers that I have in with this own user, and these are the things that suddenly you're actually figuring out, I'm maybe leaking some of these abstraction too much than compared. And I think a third thing, and we're going over some of these practices, is focusing on what your actually application size. Because I think in the start, you're maybe wondering, okay, what is actually, why do I need this? Why should I care about how quickly or how large my application is? And in the end, when we're beginning to move into these clustered environments, the quicker you're able to pull these images, the faster you're actually able to spin up these environments. And I think if you're talking a little bit later about serverless, some of these applications where you're seeing you're basically running containers per second, you're essentially running and paying for the time that you're actually pulling these images. But I think this is something in development that takes a lot of time to figure out, and it's also sometimes difficult to know how to actually make these images smaller. So Docker, at the first they had these Docker images, and people were spending a lot of time figuring out how can I actually optimize these images by running multiple commands in one layer and figuring out how can I squish these things. And Docker have done a lot of things that is really interesting lately about how can we actually squish them automatically. But they also made this multistage build. And the multistage build is something where now it's a no-brainer for making smaller images. Because before you maybe had the development image that you had all your compilers in, that you needed to do to download the programs and such. And you maybe also had some test images for setting up some things. But with multistage builds, it's actually something where you're saying, here is the container I'm going to use for doing the development, and copy all the things over to the final container. So it looks a little bit like this. This is actually the container we're using for running at connected cars in production. So you can see here is also the thing where we are giving in a argument at first called GitHub access token, and this because we are Git cloning some other projects. So basically, we are having this multiple services where we are basically taking in private repositories. And this was something that was really difficult before, because basically we were having problems where people were putting in secrets, or how do you actually get permissions to pull private repositories inside a Docker container that is not your own credentials, because you don't want to put your own SSH key into a container that you actually may ship to somebody else. But you can see this is also, and I will talk about a little bit later, but we also have our own images as a base image. And in the end, the final that's really command is like here, copy from builder into the app folder from dot to dot. And suddenly we're having an image where we have our connected cars node, where it's basically that's at 1 gigabyte or something like that. And then the connected cars node production is an Alpine image, where we're basically taking only the node code and the thing that actually need to run. And we're able to have an image that is only around 200 megabytes. So when we pull this, we can pull it incredibly quickly. And it's also something where we have this inside our GitHub repository, so we're also able to test this locally as well if you want. So one thing I really want to if people are not doing it already, is like using the official images. And although you can see, if for example go to node, we are seeing these official images that you probably have already used. That was not really the... So you can see you have all these images, and some of them is actually it's pretty easy to know. Like you just figure out what is the container name and then what's the tag. But you can also go into here where you're basically you're seeing some of these securities, where they're basically here they actually have the pushes from somewhere else. That was like changed it. But you're seeing some of these where you're actually able to also figure out what are some of the things that they're doing, because sometimes they're doing quite a lot more that if you're figuring out, I would just build a Docker container using Node, I just pull this from the apt-get repository. You're seeing here they're doing a little more to actually clean up these images and actually prepare them for you so that you have all the things that you need. And this is the Alpine image, and you're seeing this is not something you should be doing, or you actually, if you want to be doing, you should help these people do these things, because security is something that really starts from having a good base image. So, but I also think this was something really we noticed is that you kind of get a lot from making your own images in your own company, because maybe you have this tool that you kind of need, and one tool that we particularly wanted was a tool that would take our GitHub access token and make our own npm, so it would authenticate with npm and do the install from the GitHub repositories that were private. But we were also able to add some of the smaller tools that we have made ourselves for example, debugging and such. So with this is actually some of the comes in, because you don't use the latest image, and I think if you haven't learned it the hard way, it's like a pretty weird discovery once you figure out that Docker images are actually mutable, so it doesn't really matter what tag you're putting it. You can change underneath. You're not actually sure. So you're not actually sure what is inside a Docker image. You cannot say, I have this signed. You can sign it, but I think that's what really Docker wants to you to sell, this Docker Enterprise. So if you were basically tagging your images with the Git jar that you have from your repository, you're essentially saying, check out this Git on a continuous integration, tag it with this image, and you're essentially saying, this is what it should be, what is the checksum of this? And these images is also some of the things where you're saying, when I deploy it, I'm basically taking the same image that I built on continuous integration and do it in all the way through staging to production. So continuous integration, who here is building their Docker images on continuous integration? OK, that's good. Good to see. I think it's the thing of like taking and building every Git commit is sometimes maybe seen as a little bit outrageous, because you're constantly building some of the things over and over again. But in these times, it's so cheap to actually continue to build these things that I highly encourage it. And I think with something like Google Cloud Builder, it's phenomenal easy. I will say, because you can basically go into your Google console. I'm not particularly a huge fan of Google Cloud, but I think some of the things were they're basically giving you basically something for free is super interesting. So basically you go down here to the container registry and you're saying build triggers. You can basically go in here and create a build trigger. And they do this where you basically can set it up with a Google Cloud source, so you're able to push directly to Google or GitHub. And basically, you can set up a Docker continuous integration in a matter of a few seconds. So you can actually do this here where it will say, take the, for example, here, Kubernetes. I know I have this repository here that contains, need to find it. So I have this repository here with a Docker file. And basically what it does is that it's adding in that file and building as a container. So we can find it right here. And we are saying, Kevin, Kubernetes, my app, or provide my sense. They can pull the images. So basically what it do is that it will begin to clone this repository into a Google hosted repository. because then it's not having to pull from GitHub every time it has to do a new checkout. So every time they get a commit from GitHub, a webhook, they clone that, so they're only getting really the diff. And then, because if GitHub is down, that happens, I've seen it before, you basically can actually continue working without having GitHub as a dependency. Maybe your own dependencies inside the app needs to pull from GitHub, but then that's also something you can cache. But here you're basically having this thing of like having a Docker file. You can specify it within the Git repository, and you're also really easy to specify, do you want to build on a branch or a tag? And whereas my Docker file is in this, it's just in the root, and this is the repo I want to, and the commit jar. And then basically timeout, I can say it's only running for 10 minutes, and create it. And some of these things is too easy. And the other thing, while this is doing it, is basically setting up a couple of things, and I think it will actually also begin. The next thing I really want to talk about, like Google Container Registry. Maybe you are a little bit also saying, like, how do you actually store these images? And I was using Docker Hub at the start, and Docker Hub is really great. Like, it's, but it also becomes like Docker is a company. They do a lot of things, but maybe some of the things is not what is the best. And suddenly you are maybe providing on a company you're not really interacting with that much, and you're actually paying a lot for storing these images. But with the to after, so we can say run trigger, run on master, we're actually getting these images then here, and we can see them. And by the cost of only storing the raw material. So we're not paying anything per repository or the, you're paying for the transfer of data and the raw storage. So it's an incredibly good deal if you're just thinking about, okay, I have some cluster somewhere else, or I'm testing it. You can basically store your Docker images here until you figure out either hosting your own repository or figure out a better solution. And with Google as well, you're also able to do a per repository or per folder, because it's only the Google storage. You're able to also level. So you're able to really set up permissions that is really difficult normally to do on yourself. The next thing I really want to, because now we are basically having this Docker Compose up, and it was pretty easy. But the next thing you really want to maybe is like simulate a little is, because you're maybe running in Amazon or Azure, and you're having these different subnets, and some of them are not actually able to talk to each other. And this is some of where you're saying, in a relative few lines, I'm actually maybe able to replicate these ways of prohibiting different apps from actually communicating. And some of these where you, for example, maybe are saying a proxy, that's where all the traffic are coming in, and the proxy cannot talk to the backend. So you're kind of saying, okay, what is actually possible, and how I'm describing my app? You're maybe not going in to go the full Terraform way, like, or Ansible, where you're basically saying, how will I set up this app? But you're basically saying, maybe to developers that don't care about how this runs in the cloud, or they don't have access, you can basically say, you can see here, that's how it simulates a little bit in Amazon. We have two networks, they can communicate together if they're not powerful. So you're suddenly beginning to build these minimal things, and this is something you can do when you're building a new app and figuring out how to actually build this in a sound way. It's like a Docker volumes. And the normal way is you're just mounting in your own files from your own computer into the Docker volume. And this is maybe one of the biggest critics of Docker for development, Docker for Mac, Docker for Windows, is that it's incredibly slow to actually transfer the files in between in development. Like normally you're maybe seeing a performance that's like maybe depending on maybe one third of the speed for doing development with Docker for Mac or something like that. But some of these things where you still want to save the data and you're actually maybe able to do some more tricks is that using Docker volumes, you're actually getting the full speed without having to worry about you're constantly losing your data because you bring it up and down. So able to test my backup service and Docker volumes here is actually saved for every time you bring it up and down. And you can see here we have our and we're storing the same database volume inside the backup service, and you're then able to test, can we actually stop the database so it saves the file, save it in to the data volume, doing it all the time, and then actually taking and reading from the backup service. So I think some of the small steps like these are something where you're saying, okay, I can actually test some of these infrastructure things without having to go through this long route of setting it up and bootstrapping these things. And but also with service discovery, it's a big topic, like there's whole programs just figuring out how do you service discovery between your services, because it's actually pretty difficult to figure out services coming in, services going out. How do you actually get these services to find each other? And I think it's pretty naive, or like naive, how Docker do the different the service discovery. Basically, like you're using the different app names, and you're basically able to DNS on that, and these things are still, you can basically say app as a DNS name, and it would resolve that. And you're basically beginning also maybe to think about, okay, maybe I'm not going out to the internet to talk to my API. I can maybe talk through it on the internal network. And although it seems a little bit silly, you're still beginning to teach people who are new to maybe this programming of like do actually something that will continue to work and not just get on the different ports, because connecting on different ports is so time limited, it will continue to work to break, and you're not able to actually spin up multiple projects. So the limits as well is something where I see people are interested in it, but I'm not seeing people are using it. And it's really sad because some of these things are so easy to actually to set up, and you're beginning to also define some of the boundaries so you don't have to go back in certain places, like Jamie Fox, he was talking about DevOps, archaeology, where you figure out what was the intent of building this app. This app is basically saying, at most, I want to have at least 500 megabytes of memory, but I only normally need 200 and a quarter of a CPU. And here you're basically saying, this is my expectations of what I'm going to run in, but I may be going to these boundaries. And if you're doing a load balancing or load testing with a Apache benchmark where you're trying to throw a million requests and seeing if you're reaching a memory block or something like that, memory leak, which is pretty typical in some languages, you can actually maybe run memory leak detection yourself and then seeing, do I actually retrieve a OOM, like out of memory kill switch, which you will see if you're saying, if you're going over the 500 limits in the memory. And I think Docker and Kubernetes has never been really friends, and I think it's only recently when Google and really got into it. It was funny because like basically they started in 2015 at the Docker conference building this Kubernetes, and it was last year at the DockerCon here in Copenhagen they actually announced it, and it was pretty wild because at the DockerCon the same year in America in Austin they hadn't launched this Docker Kubernetes migration, and what they're doing is this weird thing of where they're basically translating your Docker stack files, your Docker compose files, into Kubernetes files for doing these easy migrations between Docker Swarm and Kubernetes. And what I would argue is that sometimes it's actually easy for actually begin to maybe have the actual Kubernetes file inside your Git repository as well to begin to do these Kubernetes, because there's no doubt Kubernetes is the winner. It's the easiest, it's the best documented, and it's the best building platform. And I think I'm not touching much about Docker or Kubernetes here. I'm having a talk as well at 15:05. But I think you're basically also able to see this app is looks a little bit similar like that. We have our Docker compose. We have our deployment. We're basically telling it we want two, so we can test that it replicates. And we're basically saying this is the container from DCR, and we are able to spin it up as we will just apply it. So Docker has this these settings here, so you basically super easy now to do Kubernetes. So in the settings here, you're basically going and say Kubernetes, enable Kubernetes, and it basically brings up a full Kubernetes node for you. So you're basically sharing all your Docker resources with Kubernetes. It takes a little bit more of a CPU and a RAM, so you're quicker run out of battery if you have enabled, but you can just go in and disable it. And you don't need more any Minikube or spinning up where you're basically applying these deployments. And you can also see here they have like which orchestrator do you want to do when you go to Docker Swarm or Kubernetes. And these you're actually able to do a real Docker deploy and do Kubernetes deploy locally without having to do these extra things, and you're doing in half a day. So no excuses not for testing out Kubernetes anymore. So I think maybe let's go to some of the production stuff, because that's also the interesting thing of how do you do Docker security. And I think one of the biggest learning I have had was like secrets should be files. And I don't know giving it as environment variables, it's not the best thing, because I've seen countless times now that somebody makes the program actually crash or some other program crash in the production that you maybe not, and then as a precaution mission is just like, hey, I'm just going to dump all the environment variables for you so you have something to debug, and there all your passwords goes into their locking system. And it's basically going to stay there forever because you never delete the logs, and you're suddenly having all these problems where people are seeing things they shouldn't see. So if you are doing these secrets, you should really mount them in as files. And it doesn't have to be difficult at the start. You can do all these HashiCorp vaults and such, but you're able to just maybe say, I have this JSON file that contains the database passwords. Just mount it in as a file, and then I know I can always read it inside the container. I can read it as /secrets. And this is really powerful because you are not now spilling any environment variables. You are actually able to read the file, maybe even with the right permissions from your right user. So if you're running on a user that maybe shouldn't read this anymore, you can maybe give it another permissions because the file would have, and you can maybe also say, after I read it, I would just delete it because now I don't need it anymore. It should only exist inside the program that needs it memory. And you are now having something, so if you're getting into these things, I know people who basically do, when they do penetration testing, they're testing out, can I get this program to spill secrets that's maybe unintentional, especially with programs like Image Magic or something like that. So one of the, like maybe the biggest takeaway from this talk is like, containers to run as read only. It's so difficult to maybe sometimes do after you have started your progress and you've done it for so long, because your program will begin to write to different temp directories. But If you can get your containers to run as read-only, you are setting yourself up for so much better security. Because the biggest security risk is often when people are able to upload a file somewhere or maybe be able to do a spill where they're basically saying, take this file, even though I expected it to be an image, it's actually a PHP file or a bash script or something like that. And if you cannot actually do these things, uploading it or something like that, and you're actually also able to say, this container, I know when it started, it's running as I intended. It's not changing anything, and I don't have to actually go into the container and check if anything changed, because I know I set it up as read-only, and it's read-only. This is also so much calmer. You can think about what is the input of the container into the service, and how would I started it, and not how did it change during the setup. Because the setup should really be that you're running it in your continuous integration, you're setting it up as it should be there, and taking that container you tested in continuous integration to staging, moving the same container to production and there. So not only provides it a lot of calmness, you don't have to go in and look at that, but it also gives you a really, really secure container. So the easy thing about doing this is basically just like you can test it yourself, dash read only. This is the command you're running, and everybody can do that. You will quickly figure out that your application is doing some things that you didn't, you're maybe not able to change, but for new projects, always start as read only in production. So maybe this is like the scary part. Like, who here have dealt with SecCom and AppArmor? Okay, like, I think I can understand you because it's really a pain. But I think this is where containers really go out of your way and begin to really make it simple, because this is really, really boring. I can see you all, and some of you're twitching a little bit because it's so boring. But you're basically seeing like some of these things where you're saying Docker do stuff for you that's really trying to limit some of these things that if you get accidentally running, or like you're setting up to defeat yourself defend yourself. That's what I meant. But you can see here some of the things that they are saying: SecCop filtering, strong defaults, and that's something you're basically saying these system calls that we are having. By default, we are limiting a lot of them to only allow the things that you should be generally allowing for running applications. And because this is such a huge thing, people are actually going in with different kind of marketing speaks. Because like Google, they just announced something called Divisor, and they launched it on Hacker News as well at KubeCon. And the marketing speak here is really long. You can see there's a lot of readme for what's supposedly a container runtime that we have seen so many times. But it's because people are now still concerned about how to actually make my container secure, how can I limit what is running inside. So what they're kind of trying to sell you on is like, here, we have our application, we have our guest kernel, we have our VM and the virtual hardware. This is normally how you would do hyper-virtualization. This is the thing that we are not doing. Here we are basically doing so much virtual things that we are taking a huge overhead. So this is how you normally do the containers, where you're saying, I'm limiting the amount of system calls that I can do. And what then Divisor is trying to sell you on is like, all the system calls is getting emulated by this process through Golang, and then you're basically saying, go through this fake system calls, and then only call through when you actually need it. And this is interesting because it's still something that people are interested about. They're still really trying to figure out how to actually host this. But it's funny because like there's one really cool person called JC France. She did all these Kubernetes and Docker security things, and she's been the one really involved with this. And she wrote about a blog post about like there's some really intensives of like echo chambers and figure out security, because Docker is secure by default. But what she wrote about is that she's basically implemented this seccom profiling. So basically, you're able to provide your own seccom profile to your Docker container. But what they also, they kind of introduced it during along the way. So what she did was actually, she implemented seccom, and then she actually tested on a lot of the containers, the most popular containers in the Docker container, Docker Hub, and to see would what she had the same defaults, were they actually making some of the applications not working? Because it's kind of making something that Docker was already like doing a lot of things, but making something that was not backward compatible would be really a mad mess. So she has been really focusing that. And so Docker is secure, and this is some of the things where you're basically, you're having these things set as easy as this. So you're saying Docker run, and you gain security opt, seccom, and then you're basically able to give your own seccom profile. And this seccom profile basically contains all the system calls that you allow or not allow. And you're basically maybe saying, this by default, I don't allow. Oh, wow, sorry. So we can go here, we can actually see what is the default seccom profile. And this may be the most easiest, but you can see here, default action is to just error out. So if you're reading, if you're seeing a system call that you don't have seen before, error it. So you can see this is the architecture support, but here you can see these system calls, those are the ones that you want to accept. So that's quite a lot, that's around 300 that they are allowing by default. And you can see here they're saying, this is the system calls we are allowing. And these are what is going in when you're using Docker right now, these are the actions you are loading in. So you can also go in and see here, these are all a little bit more about how do you actually prevent these things, because for example, you're maybe normally able to set the clock inside a container, which can maybe do a little bit of harm of like doing the actually, for example, encryption with the TLS. And you can see these are sometimes actually prevented by other things, because the Docker mentality is that even if you are secured by seccom, app armor, for example, is also enabled, and it would actually layer on top. So if you get through one of the layers, you're actually prevented by another layer. So these are the things a little bit about what is actually prohibited, for example, mount, deny mounting. But let's try to do a small demo of doing these seccom, because normally we have, for example, here say, okay, we don't want to allow that you can chat mode your containers. So here, by default, we allow everything, but these we don't allow. So we don't allow DSCMod, Joan, and Joan 32. So by default, if we have this container here, we can say here, run. And we have this container, we are basically saying, inside here, run with this seccom profile. So if I try to run this command here, run. Oh, that was a little bit quick. So we're basically saying, operation not permitted. And we basically gave our Docker container our seccom profile that says you should not be able to run CMOD. So, but how do you actually figure out this stuff for your container, which kind of containers are you running? So with that, could we use strace to figure out, because maybe you're saying, I only want to really allow these certain commands because I know I will never be able to do these kind of things. All of the 300 that are allowed, maybe I'm only using FS or something like that. So we can see here, we have here the strace command. So we have here to add this capability strace. And this is how you're basically adding capabilities that you would normally be not allowed inside the container. So here we're saying you should allow us to run trace. So let's try to run this. So now we are inside the container. Let's try to actually do the same thing as before, but now we're actually allowed to do it. So S trace, and then let's try to cmod the 400, and then the slash. So you can see here, these are all the system calls that we are running. So here, we are getting actually and running this system call cmod, and we're calling it on slash, and then, but you're basically able to see all system calls and figuring out what your application are actually running, and you can see it actually returns to zero. So it's quite easy to begin to look into what commands are your container running. Maybe begin to limit down what are you actually allowing your container to run and actually prohibiting to do these commands, especially something if you know beforehand what you're going to do. So I think maybe how that ties into is like these things is what I did at Connected Cars. Like, I don't know how much time we have left. It's running a little bit out. But these things, 5 minutes, that's good. We are running, was did on Connected Cars. And some of the things I learned doing these things, but it also some of the things where you're basically, with these things that we're doing, handling private customers' data, we were making this box that we put inside the car, and it basically told us what is the GPS positions, what is wrong with the car, sends error code. And this was incredibly important for me that we kind of did the most things we could do to make this secure. Because I wouldn't have on my plate that somebody says, you could do more to make this secure, or figure out how can I prevent this. And the thing about Docker and Docker Compose and this is actually, it gave me a lot of tools to actually do the secure thing, the secure default from the start, really focus on security as a first thought and not as an afterthought of, or people that you kind of hire in because they are experts. Everybody can do this in a couple of days and figure out how to actually lock my application down to only do the amount of minimum and figure out what is the next step to make this more secure. And I think this is also maybe going into some of the serverless stuff because you're seeing with technology, but you are even in a more tightly environment where you can do even less. So all these things where you're basically taking in, simulating what you have in production in your own computer, because if you're just running Docker containers, you're basically only you're doing yourself a huge problem where you basically have to figure out later how you do it. So basically, the summary here I really want you to take away with and go from here is like be able to bring up your environment in one command. Your future colleagues would really appreciate you. Run as read-only and really focusing on having something consistency. Secret as files, because like this is the easiest way to not have an accidental headache. And also seccom is powerful because you can do it, I can do it. It's just about getting started on figuring out what is the right seccom for your application instead of the default one from Docker. So with that, thank you for listening. Maybe we have time for one question. Does somebody have a question? Yeah. Yeah. Hub. Yeah.
But the one thing I don't understand is that almost none of them have a handshake built in. And I don't understand that.
Which kind of handshake?
Hashtag.
Hashtag?
No, hashtag. It's a epic service is running.
No, health tech. Just sorry for that. Yeah. Yeah, that's kind of a new thing. And it's because it's only limited to your actually cluster implementation. So, for example, if you're building your Docker container, you're not actually using it for anything. But it's a good idea to add, and it's really nice because you're kind of defining as well what is your application and how should it expect to be healthy. So it's a really good idea. So, okay, thank you.